Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. The Adventure of the Priory School. An audiobook, narrated by David McCran. We have had some dramatic entrances and exits upon our small stage at Baker Street, but I cannot recollect anything more sudden and startling than the first appearance of Thorneycroft Huxtable, M.A., Ph.D., etc. His card, which seemed too small to carry the weight of his academic distinctions, preceded him by a few seconds, and then he entered himself. So large, so pompous, and so dignified that he was the very embodiment of self-possession and solidity. And yet his first action, when the door had closed behind him, was to stagger against the table, whence he slipped down upon the floor, and there was that majestic figure, prostrate and insensible, upon our bearskin hearthrug. We had sprung to our feet, and for a few moments we stared in silent amazement at this ponderous piece of wreckage which told of some sudden and fatal storm far out on the ocean of life. Then Holmes hurried with a cushion for his head and I with the brandy for his lips. The heavy white face was seamed with lines of trouble, and hanging pouches under the closed eyes were leaden in colour, the loose mouth drooped dolorously at the corners, the rolling chins were unshaven. Collar and shirt bore the grime of a long journey, and the hair bristled unkempt from the well-shaped head. It was a sorely stricken man who lay before us. "What is it, Watson?" asked Holmes. "Absolute exhaustion, probably mere hunger and fatigue," said I, with my finger on the thready pulse where the stream of life trickled thin and small. "Return ticket from Mackleton in the north of England," said Holmes, drawing it from the pocket watch. "It is not 12 o'clock yet. He has certainly been an early starter." The puckered eyelids had begun to quiver, and now a pair of vacant grey eyes looked up at us. An instant later, the man had scrambled onto his feet, his face crimson with shame.
"Forgive this weakness, Mr. Holmes. I have been a little overwrought. Thank you. If I might have a glass of milk and a biscuit, I have no doubt that I should be better. I came personally, Mr. Holmes, in order to ensure that you would return with me. I feared that no telegram would convince you of the absolute urgency of the case."
"When you are quite restored..."
"I am quite well again. I cannot imagine how I came to be so weak. I wish you, Mr. Holmes, to come to Mackleton with me by the next train."
My friend shook his head. "My colleague Dr. Watson could tell you that we are very busy at present. I am retained in this case of the Ferrers documents, and the Abergavenny murder is coming up for trial. Only a very important issue could call me from London at present."
"Important?"
Our visitor threw up his hands.
"Have you heard nothing of the abduction of the only son of the Duke of Holdernesse?"
"What? The late cabinet minister?"
"Exactly. We have tried to keep it out of the papers, but there was some rumour in the Globe last night. I thought it might have reached your ears."
Holmes shot out his long thin arm and picked out volume H in his encyclopedia of reference. "Holdernesse, 6th Duke, KG, PC, half the alphabet, Baron Beverley, Earl of Carston. Dear me, what a list! Lord Lieutenant of Hallamshire since 1900. Married Edith, daughter of Sir Charles Appledore, 1888. Heir and only child, Lord Saltire. Owns about 250,000 acres. Minerals in Lancashire and Wales. Address, Carlton House Terrace, Holdernesse Hall, Hallamshire, Carston Castle, Bognor, Wales. Lord of the Admiralty, 1872. Chief Secretary of State for Well, well, this man is certainly one of the greatest subjects of the crown.
The greatest and perhaps the wealthiest. I am aware, Mr. Holmes, that you take a very high line in professional matters, and that you are prepared to work for the work's sake. I may tell you, however, that His Grace has already intimated that a check for £5,000 will be handed over to the person who can tell him where his son is, and another £1,000 to him who can name the man or men who have taken him.
It is a princely offer, said Holmes. Watson, I think that we shall accompany Dr. Huxtable back to the north of England. And now, Dr. Huxtable, when you have consumed that milk, you will kindly tell me what has happened, when it happened, how it happened, and finally, what Dr. Thorneycroft Huxtable of the Priory School near Mackleton has to do with the matter, and why he comes 3 days after an event. The state of your chins gives the date. To ask for my humble services. Our visitor had consumed his milk and biscuits. The light had come back to his eyes and the colour to his cheeks as he set himself with great vigour and lucidity to explain the situation.
I must inform you, gentlemen, that the Priory is a preparatory school of which I am the founder and principal. Huxtable's sidelights on Horace may possibly recall my name to your memories. The Priory is, without exception, the best and most select preparatory school in England. Lord Leverstoke, the Earl of Blackwater, Sir Cathcart Soames, they all have entrusted their sons to me. But I felt that my school had reached its zenith when, weeks ago, the Duke of Holdernesse sent Mr. James Wilder, his secretary, with intimation that young Lord Saltire, 10 years old, his only son and heir, was about to be committed to my charge. Little did I think that this would be the prelude to the most crushing misfortune of my life. On May the 1st, the boy arrived, that being the beginning of the summer term. He was a charming youth, and he soon fell into our ways. I may tell you, I trust that I am not indiscreet, but half-confidences are absurd in such a case, that he was not entirely happy at home. It is an open secret that the Duke's married life had not been a peaceful one, and the matter had ended in a separation by mutual consent, the Duchess taking up her residence in the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.